top of us, is it?
Yeah, just. Yeah. Hi folks, this is Jay and this is
Mike,
and we're here to share the gospel and just to help you do apologetics concerning Islam, how to answer questions concerning Islam, and we might cover one or two other topics as well. Just sit up here, we can move up a bit nearer. Yeah. So I'm just going to pray and then we'll get started. Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for your love. And Father, we just pray that this video will be a blessing to Christians, that it would encourage them in their walk with you. And Father, we pray it would be a help to Muslims and atheists and all sorts of people, Lord, that they might learn about you, Lord, and come to know you as Lord and Saviour. So Lord, I just pray you be in this video and may it be a blessing to people. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen.
Amen. So we're Manchester Street Preachers and Evangelists, and we go out evangelizing. And Mike, can you tell the people today what we've been doing today?
Yes. We've been out witnessing the gospel today in Cheetham Mill. Sorry, not in Cheetham Mill, I do apologise. In Rusholme and Longsight. So basically, we've been standing on the street, giving out leaflets. We've had our cross with us and the video, and generally we're just trying to engage with people, get into conversations with people, Muslims, anyone really, and speak to them about the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ. So we've been doing that today, and we keep doing this each and every week. We try and reach people, and we're hoping to get as many people saved as possible, and to reach the people out there that really need to hear the good news of Jesus Christ. So I do encourage you, if you are a Christian in the Christian faith or in the church, just and you feel the need to go and tell people about Jesus, then just get a few of you together and go out and do it. Get some tracts, you can get them online or from a Christian shop, and do some study on Islam and other religions and atheism, and just go out there and give it a try. You might stumble a few times, but just give it a go, and you will. You know, it's a good thing to be witnessing for Christ, because we are his witnesses. So I just urge you to just do it and just stand by us and do what we do.
You've been helping me out now for, how long have you been helping me out now?
I'd say since maybe February, March time, something like that.
There's me, you, Kieran and a few others. How have you found it over the last... over those months, coming, joining us and being with us? And
It's been very rewarding. It's been exciting, challenging, and it's been very interesting. When you're out there on the street, you do meet a lot of all kinds of different walks of life. You meet all kinds of situations and people, and it's good to be prepared. Be prepared and be careful as well. Be very careful. Don't do it. I wouldn't suggest go and do it alone. I'd suggest that you get a few of you to do it, and it's safety in numbers, as they say. So yeah, it's been very good. It's been really good. It's been really rewarding. So far, we've spoke to some Muslims. We met on the street. We've been invited to their mosque, and we've managed to get them in the actual church to listen to the gospel. So we had a bit of a breakthrough there. And we still got contact with these Muslims now, and they just seem to be wanting to know a bit more about the Christian faith and asking a lot of questions. So do your homework, study, and just go out there and do it, and don't be afraid.
And what would you say, from when you first started, when I first met you, you started with us doing street evangelism, to today, what would you say... didn't you know then, and what you know now? What lessons has God taught you over that time from today? And how would that help somebody?
Okay. The lessons that I've learned since I started preaching with Jason on the street. I've learned to be, what's the word, humble, more humble with people and more gentle, a bit more kinder. And it's taught me to be, is to speak to people as people, not as really people from different faiths, and look at them differently.
Sorry, that's Mike's phone.
That's my phone. I had a feeling that was going to go off.
Good.
Yeah, I've learned a lot from Jason. I've learned from his apologetics and stuff that he knows, and I've learned a lot from Kieran as well and other Christians that I've met. So it's strengthened me in the fact that if I do have to talk about my faith in any situation, I'm more stronger to stand against any kind of attack on it. Mm. I'll be able to stand my ground because I know I've got people behind me that are supportive of me and believe in what I believe in, you know, we're in it together.
Mm.
Sorry about the phone.
So we're going to just talk for a bit about Islam, and me and Mike particularly have a passion for Muslims and for Islam and learning about it. So I'm going to ask Mike just to share some of the issues that he's been studying, and then I'll share a few things that I've been looking at. So do you want to, and we'd encourage you, from what we've done, from the studies that we've done, Mike and I'll reference people to go and study and sites and things, and so we hope this video will be a resource for you to study Islam and answer Muslims' questions, but also for you to go out and reach Muslims as well. But we're not just going to do Islam. If we've got time, I'd like to just pick up on gay and lesbian issues and atheism if we've got time. But so this video is going to be a resource for doing apologetics on the streets, doing street evangelism. So over to you, Mike. Any things that stand out for you in your research recently over the last 4 or 5 months about Islam?
Yeah, what I found out about Islam is the claims that are made by the Muslim faith. Now, the Muslim faith claims that the Quran is the perfect word of God. It's never been changed, and it never can be changed, and it's contradiction free. Now, the thing is, that falls into the fallacy of a false assumption, okay? And this works in logic as well as in law. Historical precedent means that the burden of proof rests on those who set forth new theories and not on those whose ideas have already been verified.
So basically, what source is this you quoted? Can you give the source so that people?
Yeah, sure. This is let's have a look now. It's called Common Logical Fallacies Made by Muslims by Robert A. Murray, and it's from the Research and Education Foundation of Religion. Okay. Now, the problem with Islam is it makes claims that don't stand up. Okay. So basically, as you well know, Christianity came before the rise of Islam. And since Islam came many centuries after Christianity, the burden of proof is not on us, but on Islam to prove their claims, and not on ourselves. But we can prove our case if we do our research properly. Okay.
Can I just say, that's important, because what the Muslims will do when you're talking on the streets, or if you go to Hyde Park or talk on streets, they will always ask you questions and very reluctant to defend their own position. So it's important what Mike says for you, as quickly as possible, for them to stop asking you questions and you ask them questions, because they need to answer questions as well.
Yeah, and you'll find as well when you start to talk about the Quran and you start to dig deep on the Quran, they get very defensive, and the first thing they'll do after that is attack the Bible. They'll attack the Bible, attack the Bible, attack the Bible.
Mm.
So we have to be strong when we're facing Muslims. We have to stick to a particular topic with regards to the Quran, and we stay on that topic.
Mm.
what they do as well, they argue in a circle.
Okay.
They prove Allah by the Quran, and they prove the Quran by Allah. That's arguing in a circle. They've gone round in a circle and they've proved nothing. Okay. So I would always ask a Muslim, can you give me something outside of the Quran that proves your case for Islam? Give me something solid, historically, something that we can actually look at and pull apart.
Mm.
And 9 times out of 10, you'll find they can't do it. They can't do it. Mm. They'll just keep throwing the Quran back at you, saying it's perfectly preserved. It's never been changed.
Mm.
So that's their main defence, basically. Okay. And the Bible will be attacked all the time. Okay. Another thing what I found interesting about Muslims and Islam is that they make claims about Muhammad, about the Bible, yet their scriptures don't support these claims. So what one of the things they'll say is that Muhammad was perfect, that he didn't sin, that none of the prophets sinned, they were all perfect. But if you did your research on that, you'll find that the Quran says that Muhammad did sin, prophets do sin.
Mm.
So everything they believe goes against what is actually taught in the Quran. And you'll find this inconsistency with them.
Mm.
You'll find this backward thinking about the religion. It's very hard to get at the root with them. So you've got to be patient with them, but keep ploughing away and showing them how wrong it is what they're actually saying.
Mm.
So, yeah.
You got any more? Okay. Do you remember that time we had a chat with a Muslim? There's actual video of it, if you have a look, of Mike talking to a Muslim guy in Manchester. So if you have a look on our YouTube channel, you'll find that debate. It's a really good debate. Do you remember that debate? And you actually showed him from the Quran some things about Jesus.
Yes.
Can you remember anything about that?
I'll just have a quick look in my notes.
Because you took, I think you might have gone to Revelation to show, and then the Quran to show that Jesus is God.
Oh yes, that's correct, yes.
Do you remember?
I do. We as Christians believe that Jesus is God, and the Muslims will say, no, Jesus can't be God. So what I did my homework, and I actually got some passages from the Bible to prove that Jesus is God. Okay.
Can you go through them then?
Yeah, sure. So one of them is, if you've got a Bible ready, Isaiah 44 verse 6. It says, the Lord God is the first and the last. Revelation 22 13 says, Jesus says, I am the first and the last. Revelation 1 17 to 18, Jesus says, I am the first and the last. If you go to the Old Testament, Psalm 10:16 says, the Lord is King forever. And Revelation 19:16 says the same thing, the Lord is King forever. Psalm 98:6 says, shout for joy before the Lord the King. 1 Timothy 15, God the blessed and holy ruler, the King of kings and Lord of lords. Revelation 17 verse 14. The Lamb will triumph over them because he is Lord of Lords and King of Kings. He's talking about Jesus here. John 1:29. Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Psalm 47 verse 2. For the Lord Most High is awesome, the great King over all the earth. Psalm 47 verse 7. For God is the King of all the earth. Jeremiah 10:10. But the Lord is the true God. He is the living God. He is the true God. So all these references point to the deity of Christ, the lordship of Christ, the sonship of Christ, and that Jesus is actually God. It shows the intimacy of that relationship between the Father and the Son.
Yeah.
So Muslims just need to join the dots and the I's. Yeah. And if we research this stuff and we can put it together in a concise manner, it's going to add more weight to an argument when we're speaking to Muslims about the truth of God.
But didn't you also link it in with the Quran?
The Quran.
Do you remember? You had I don't matter if you haven't got it.
I don't think I've got it on me.
But it was really good. I think there's actual verses where it says that when Jesus says, in Revelation, he is the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the last. And then Isaiah, it says that God is the beginning and the last. But then in the Quran, it says that God is the beginning and the last. So the same phrase that is used in the Quran is used in Isaiah, but it's also used in Revelation of Jesus, proving that he's God. Yeah. So you'll have to look at the specific verses on that.
Yeah.
So I just want to share one or two things about a couple of things that you can read. There's a book that you could get hold of by Keith Small on the textual criticism of the Quran. And he gave a lecture at Maktoum College on Wednesday, 20th February 2013. And he gives a lecture and he shows that what some of the earliest Qurans that we have, one from Yemen, a Palmist Quran, that on the surface of the Quran, there's been writing put on other writing which has been washed off. And the writing that's been washed off, when we look at the ultraviolet light, it shows that it's not the same Quran as the Quran that's been written on top. It's proving categorically that the Quran has been changed and adapted. Now, Muslims don't want to hear about this, they don't think much about that, but it's true. And so it's important that you to study a bit of the history of the Quran and look at scholars like Keith Small, and you'll find out that the Quran has changed, and that'll be valuable information if you actually talk to Muslims. And there are other texts that you could research if you wanted to research. And if you type in an article called A Critical Look at the Newest Historical Research on Islam and the Earliest Quranic Manuscripts, so that's the title, A Critical Look at the Newest Historical Research on Islam and the Earliest Quranic Manuscripts, and read this article and learn some of the information about these texts called the top copy text. One scholar, Islamic scholar, says that Dr. Taylor Al-Kulkak says, no seriously scholarly work has been done on it. It says there are 22% of the Quran missing, and there are 2,270 consonantal differences. In other words, it's not a perfect text, proving that the Quran has changed. So do some research on the history of the text of the Quran, and that would be a good way of showing that the Quran has changed.
Yeah. And one of the Muslim claims is that the Quran has always existed on eternal tablets in heaven, and that cannot be the case if the text has been changed, as Jay has just pointed out. So that claim that it's been preserved is totally erroneous and false, because Islam stands or falls on the fact that there's no contradictions in it and that it's been preserved. But I will add, though, preservation of a text doesn't actually mean it's from God, basically.
Mm. We could have preserved Shakespeare's writings perfectly, but it doesn't mean that it's God's word.
Yeah.
But it hasn't been perfectly preserved. The text has been corrupted.
Yeah.
And it can be proven so.
Yeah.
If you go to debate.org.uk, and look at an article called The 7 Deadly Questions of Islam. It's a brilliant, simple article, and it gives you some information in talking to Muslims. The 7 Deadly Questions of Islam. He says, it is fruitless to try to share the gospel with Muslims who think that the Bible has been corrupted, since even if he was persuaded to reject the Quran, he would never accept the implications of the Bible until he was sure that it was authentic. So he says, we begin with what the Quran says about the Bible. Many verses actually confirm that it is God's word and has not been changed. Here are only a few examples. Surah 5:43. How come they to how come they to you for judgment when they have the Torah, wherein are contained the commandments of God? Surah 5:44. We God did reveal the Torah wherein guidance and light. Surah 5:46. We sent Jesus, confirming that which was revealed before him in the Torah, and we bestowed on him the gospel wherein is guidance and light. So actually, if you do a study of the Quran, it's very favorable to the Bible. It doesn't say the Bible's changed. Mm. So I would encourage you to get a concordance of the Quran and look at all the verses in the Quran that talk about the Bible, and you'll find that there's nothing in there that says the Quran has changed. So when you talk to a Muslim and they say the Bible's changed, you can always say, well, your own Quran says it hasn't changed. So that's a helpful argument. And you can get information off debate.org.uk, the 7 deadly questions of Islam. Any thoughts on that, Mike?
Yeah, brilliant sources, brilliant. Another thing to show to Muslims is that the burden of proof is not on us, it's on them, because they're claiming things that are different to what the Bible claims. So if they say to us, well, the Quran judges the Bible, then it's not, it's the opposite way around. Okay. Now, there is a lot of historical evidence for the Bible, so I would suggest that you look at the historical evidence for the Bible as well, because most of the attacks you'll find are aimed at the Bible. So if we just rely on the Bible to state our case, they'll just reject it and say it's been changed, how you can trust it. So it's good to have some backup and some sources to quote why the Bible is reliable and why it can be trusted, and then show them why the Quran is not a source from God. Show them that it has got mistakes, it has got contradictions, and the whole system of Islam will just fall based on that one thing, that there's no contradictions. But what I did find with Muslims is if you do show them contradictions, they'll either deny them, reject them, or they'll flip around and start changing the subject or attack the Bible, or they'll say, need to go to a scholar, for example. But it's just simple mistakes that you can show them.
Have you got your Quran?
I have in the bag, yes.
Yeah, could you get your Quran out?
I can, yes.
So if you want to get a Quran, we'll look at some Quranic verses. Yeah. Thanks, mate. Will you look them up when I read them out?
Yeah, I've some marks from off here.
So, just go back to what Mike said, which we'll go into in a minute, about historical. You know, we have loads of evidence for historical facts of Jesus. This is a booklet that you can get, and it's really good to get it and be able to put it in your Bible, and this is lots of historical facts that have been confirmed in the Bible, and you know, it says crucifixion evidence, 1968, the bones of a young man who had been crucified during New Testament times was found in Jerusalem. So that's the crucifix bone in the feet of a guy, proving there was crucifixion in the time of Jesus. So this is lots of historical data proving the Bible's as being correct on all that it's saying. Now, you can get this at Rose Publishing, 50 Proofs of the Bible, and it's really good, helpful booklet to get hold of. 50 Proofs of the Bible, I would recommend that you get hold of that. It's very, very helpful. Another booklet to get hold of is Understanding the Gospels, Why the Gospels Are Historical Reliable. And this is by Rose Publishing, and it gives you a harmony of the Gospels. It talks about the miracles of Jesus, and it talks about manuscript evidence, etc. So that's a very, very good booklet as well. So we're just going to look at a couple of Quranic verses. Are you all right?
Yeah, that's all right.
Okay, if you turn to Surah 4:34. So we're just going to look at some of the issues in the Quran that you can bring up with Muslims, just to get them to think about that the Quran isn't the word of God.
Yeah.
Surah 4:34.
Do you want me to read this?
Yeah.
Okay. Men are the protectors and maintainers of women, because Allah has made one of them to excel the other, and because they spend to support them from their means. Therefore, the righteous women are devoutly obedient to Allah and to their husbands, and guard in the husband's absence what Allah orders them to guard, their chastity and their husband's property. As to those women on whose part you see ill conduct, admonish them first, refuse to share their beds, and last, beat them if it is useful. But if they obey you, seek not against them. Surely Allah is ever most high, most great.
That'll do. So the Muslims will try to get out of that and doing some nice footwork with Arabic and so-called context. But that's very simple, easy to understand, that verse is saying that it's okay to beat your wife. And it can't be the word of God if it's advocating that. So that's something that you could bring up. If you turn to Surah 19, verse 27 and 28. You're all right, take time, you're all right.
Surah 19:27. Then she brought him to her people, carrying him. They said, O Maryam, Mary, indeed you have brought a thing.
You want me to read it?
Not the right one.
Surah 19:27.
Yeah.
And then 28.
Oh, right, okay.
All sister, the like of Haram, Aaron, your father was not a man who used to commit adultery, nor your mother was an unchaste woman. So that passage teaches that Mary is the sister of Aaron. Right.
Sorry.
Now, it's confusing Miriam of the Old Testament, which lived 2,000 years ago. So there's a direct contradiction there. Muslims will try to get out of it and say, oh, it doesn't. But another surah, Surah 333, actually confirms that the interpretation that we're given is the correct interpretation. And then if you turn to Surah 7, 54 and 103, and then Surah 11, verse 7, you'll find that the Quran teaches that on one side it says the world was created in 8 generations, and then another verse, it says it was created in 6 generations.
Yeah.
Some translations say days. Whether it's days or whether it's generations, there's a contradiction. One is saying 6, one is saying 8. Yeah. Now, Dr. Zaki Naik tries to get out of it and says that 2 days or 2 generations were in the 6. But if you look at it clearly, the context is a chronological order, and that chronological order is 2, 4, 2, and then in the other text it's 6, and so you can't get out of it. There's a contradiction there.
Yeah.
So there are contradictions in the Quran. Do your spared work. Do look at the context. There's also a surah that says the sun sets in muddy waters. Muhammad in a hadith was asked about this, and he said that the sun sets in water. So it confirms the interpretation that if you look at it, it does say that the sun sets in muddy waters. So Muslims try to get out of these things, but when you actually go into the context, it actually shows them to be wrong.
Yeah.
So there are contradictions there.
Mm.
Look at them, study the context, look at the opposing views, and make sure you've got some information. And I used this last week on about 6 Muslim lads, and they were really devastated when I brought some of these points out. So they're just ways of getting people to think.
Yeah. Plus as well, what you'll find with the Quran is there's a lot of plagiarism as well.
Mm.
There's a lot of stuff in here that's obviously been copied from the Bible, but given a different twist, a different meaning.
Mm.
So I'll just read some of the plagiarisms that I found. If you look at Surah 26:33, and then compare it to Exodus 4:6 in the Bible, you can see it's an obvious plagiarism. It's been borrowed by Muhammad. Genesis 1:1-5, Surah 6:1, Surah 17:12, Genesis 1:2, Surah 11:7. There's many more. I've got a whole list of them here, but you'll find a lot of plagiarism in the Bible.
Mm.
Sorry, a lot of plagiarism from the Bible in the Quran.
In the Quran, yeah.
Yeah. So if it is a book of God and it's the final revelation to man, why is so much biblical information in here? Why is it not different, and why is it not giving the message what Muslims so claim to hold dearly to, believe in the one God, but rather it's just an answer to biblical Christianity and Judaism. This book is not the final revelation of God. It's just it's Muhammad's response to Christianity and Judaism and his misguided understanding of it, and it's just a mishap of contradictions and fallacies, and it's not worth the paper it's written on, folks.
Just a question on that. Reading the Quran and reading the Bible, what's your impression? When you read the Quran and read the Bible, I'll give you mine in a second, but what is your impression after reading the Quran and you read the Bible, your initial thoughts?
My initial thought is this: it's obvious from reading the Bible and the Quran which one is from God and which one isn't from God. Because the Bible has stories in it that begin, they have middles and they have ends. The Quran doesn't have any kind of unity or continuity. People appear, stories appear out of nowhere and then they disappear again. And it doesn't make any sense what it's actually saying. The Bible is supernatural. Mm. When you read the Bible, it speaks to your heart.
Mm.
And the unity of scripture in the Bible is so profound and so supernaturally unified, it could only have come from God. And it's God breathed. The Quran is man breathed, unfortunately.
I read the Quran, and to be honest, there is no way that is the word of God. Absolutely no way. Because the Bible is just so beautiful in that it's a one unity written over 2,000 years, and it's got one message, and it's lifting Christ up.
Mm.
And the Quran is in no way the word of God compared to the Bible. A couple of things to say. There is information that you can get on debate.org.uk on Jay Smith's website, where they go out and debate Muslims in Hyde Park. And at debate.org.uk, I'll just make sure that is the... debate.org.uk. If you go to debate.org.uk and download some of the PDF information. Now, they have an article called Facts Frequently Asked Questions, and they put out a paper and it gives you bits of information like this. Did Jesus really die on the cross? It says, eyewitnesses need to corroborate what happened. Three eyewitnesses versus one supposition. In other words, you've got eyewitnesses and then you've got a supposition that came 700 to 900 years later. Yeah. Four Gospels that are based on eyewitnesses and versus the Quran. Who do you believe? There's extra biblical evidence. Phallus, 50 AD. Josephus, 80-90 AD. Tacitus, 80 AD. Pliny the Younger, 112 AD. So there's lots of historical data to show that Christ died on the cross, and the Quran isn't correct. But this is a really helpful thing to read. It gives you information about doing evangelism with Muslims, some of the key questions, and it's called Facts Frequently Asked Questions, and it's by Jay Smith and his people. Do you want to read that?
Yeah, sure. Oh, yeah.
What you want to read there?
Oh, right, yeah, it was just backing up the historians that you just mentioned. Tacitus, Pliny the Younger, Suetonius, Josephus, and also we have the Jewish Talmud as well, which is a it's a, what's the word now? It's hostile. It's hostile, but it still says Jesus was crucified. So,
well, it says specifically he was hanged, but the word hang in those times by the Jews is synonymous to crucifixion, because Paul says Jesus was hanged.
Yeah.
And but for a Jew that meant crucifixion.
Yeah, that's right. And basically the Gospels do give us a comprehensive account of Jesus' life, his ministry. It includes specific details about people, places and times, the hallmarks of authentic history. An example is found at Luke 3, verses 1 to 2, which helps us to establish the exact date when a man named John the Baptist, a forerunner of Jesus, commenced his work. Luke wrote, in the 15th year of the reign of Tiberius Caesar, when Pontius Pilate was governor of Judea, Herod was district ruler of Galilee, Philip his brother was district ruler of the country of Iturea, and Trachonitis and Lysanias was district ruler of Abilene in the days of chief priest Annas and Sapphias. God's declaration came to John, the son of Zechariah, in the wilderness. This detailed, precise list enables to establish that God's declaration came to John in the year 29 CE. So the Bible in itself is evidence of establishing a timeline.
Okay, thank you for that, Mike. So, So, we're, have you got any more time?
I would say invest in a book like that, or a book like this, and read them and really get to grips with what it's saying.
Can I just get this one?
Yeah, of course you can.
This is Amy or Ewing, IVP, InterVersity Press. Amy or Ewing is the European Director for RZM Zacharias Trust and Directorial Programmes for the Oxford Centre for Christian Apologetics, a popular speaker of conferences and author. She is a really, really good apologist, and she's written a book there, Why Trust the Bible. So get hold of that and really digest it. It will really help you. We encourage you to read that. Have you got that Answering Islam in your bag? No. There's a book by Norman Geisler and somebody else who I can't remember called Answering Islam. That's very helpful. And also a couple of websites to go to. Answering Islam is a really good website where you can learn about answering Muslim questions. Go to, for about the Bible, is the Bible reliable? The Ehrman Project. If you type in Ehrman Project, that will give you some information, a good website about why we can trust the Bible. And there is the C.S. Lewis Trust is a good place to do, where you can do apologetics. Zacharias Ministries is very helpful. And just trying to think of and a couple of apologies to Muslims that are very good is David Wood, Nabil Quresh, and
Sam Shimon,
and
James White.
Those are all very good apologies. So who are they again?
There's Nabil Quresh.
Yeah.
There's James White.
Yeah.
Sam Shimon.
Yeah.
David Wood.
Yeah.
And what's the other one called? Can't think of his name.
Sam Shimon, David Wood, James White.
Yeah, Sam Shimon, we got that one, haven't we? Nabil Qureshi.
We got the main ones.
We got the main ones. These are the Christian apologists that main the big people like Zach and I will not debate, because his reasoning is that they must draw in a big massive crowd for him to go and debate them. That was the same argument that the other guy used to use, who was that other Muslim debate who died?
Didat,
yeah, same attitude.
Yeah, basically they won't debate our best scholars because they're scared of them, basically.
Yeah, they're scared of me.
All right, I've got one or two questions. We'll finish there because we haven't got time to do other topics like Jehovah's Witnesses and things like that.
Yeah.
But I'd just like us to talk about, just a minute, we're planning, we're not going to tell you the date, but we are planning to go down to Hyde Park and we're going to share the gospel and we're hoping to see souls saved, but we're also hoping to debate some of the people down there, some of the Muslim apologists. But I just want Mike and I to share our thoughts of what we've been watching and experienced about Hyde Park, about the Christians going into Hyde Park, and what advice we can give them when they go to Hyde Park. So do you want to share your observations that you've been studying over the last few months, Christians who've been going to Hyde Park and debating the Muslims. So what are your observations about the Muslims and your observations about the Christians going down to Hyde Park?
Yeah, well, I would say if you are going to go down to Hyde Park and debate the Muslims, they are prepared. So I would urge you for you to be prepared.
Mm.
Be like that Boy Scout, be prepared, do your research, look at what they're saying, look at how they debate, what they say and the tactics that they use. And I would study them as well as studying the literature you need to use to combat what they're actually saying.
Mm.
So I would say you need to be tough, you have to be assertive, and don't let them escape from you when you're trying to debate them. Stick to a subject that you're strong on, stick to that subject, research it, look at the claims for and against it, go the extra mile and look at the different scholars and what they say about that, and have things printed off, documented, and have it ready, and stick to that one subject that you're strong on. Because what they'll try and do, they'll try and get you all over the show. They'll jump from subject to subject to subject to subject, and they'll have you running around like a don't know what. So be prepared, stand your ground, and don't let them take control. You stand the ground and you tell them straight and give it to them, basically.
I want to reiterate that again, what Mike has said. If you're going down to Hyde Park, I went down to Hyde Park a few months ago with a friend called Kieran. We went down. We had a good time, and I did a lot of preparation. I've debated a lot of people, and I went down there, did my preparation, but there was one guy, a Muslim guy, I didn't do any research on, a Muslim apologist. I went down there, he got me into a conversation, and I was stumped within a few minutes because he wanted me to drag me into his kind of apologetic, but I didn't even know what kind of apologetic he was going to use because I didn't study him. So you've got to go down really, really prepared, and you've got to keep on the topic that you want to keep on. So my expertise is resurrection, Mike's expertise is you're studying Muslim questions. So really grapple with the topic and know everything about that topic, the arguments for it, against it, the scholars for, scholars against. Because what I've been seeing and what Mike's been seeing is Christians are going down there, they mean well, but they're not doing preparation. You're not doing enough preparation. And you're being made to look silly because the Muslim scholars and debaters are filming you and you've not done your homework. So you really need to do your homework and stick to a topic that you know well and don't let them get you on that other, on their whatever they want to do. Don't go there. Just stick to what you want to talk about. Know your topic well and... You know, assume that they're going to find out what you believe and what you've been studying. So you've got to go one step ahead of them. Like Mike said, do extra research, which even the Christian scholars have not done, so that you go down and you really are prepared to be able to debate properly. Now, here's one more thing that I just want to say and about evangelism. Mike, when we evangelize, some people will say this, and we've had this said to us. Some people will say, all you need is the Spirit. You don't need to study. You don't need to do apologetics. Some people will say, you just need to love people.
Yeah.
So what is the balanced attitude to why we do debates on apologetics? When you've seen me, Is all that I do debate people? Is that all I do? Or is there anything else I do? Or is there any other kind of ideas that I have when I'm doing that?
Yeah, you debate people, but also you speak to people on their level. And it's not always necessarily about winning the debate or who can shout the loudest. Jay actually speaks to him one-on-one, and he tells him gently about the gospel, salvation, and what he needs to do right. And he uses the Bible in the right way to show them why they need Jesus, basically. Because it says that we've all broken God's law, we've all sinned, and Jay demonstrates this and shows them that we've all done it, and that the only way that we can get right is having Christ as our Saviour. And he makes it clear to them that there is an eternity. And most people today, except the atheists, they're not stupid. They know in their mind or in their somewhere in their soul, they know that there's something beyond this. And this is what Dre draws them to that and makes it a reality that there is an eternity, and they need to understand that eternity. And by bringing them that gospel, he's bringing them hope where there wasn't hope, and he's bringing clarification on God, who God is and who God isn't, basically. Because there's a lot of misconceived ideas about who God is. There's a lot of hearsay, there's a lot of opinions, but not facts. It's all a mixture of ideas, but we're not dealing with ideas, we're dealing with solid facts, we're dealing with the Word of God, and we're going to give people the Word of God. And we do that. Jay does that through his preaching, and he does it on a one-to-one, and he does it through debate, reason and logic. And that's what he does. He uses the whole spectrum of his ability, what God's given him, to draw people to Jesus and to tell them of the good news, basically. And he gives them the grace, the truth, and the balance is there completely. And if you listen to him and speak to him and you're honest with him, and you're not there to attack him as a person or attack him or what he's doing, but actually listen to what he's saying, you'll benefit, and you'll come to the truth and get saved. And that's all we want to do, is to reach out and get you saved, because we know that this world, it's full of lies, and we just want to bring the truth. And if we have to suffer abuse for that truth, then we'll go through that, and that's what we're willing to do.
And everybody on a couple of things is that everybody on the team believes in the power of the Holy Spirit, that we can't do anything unless we depend on the Holy Spirit. Everybody on the team believes in preaching Christ crucified, that we preach a cross. So we always bring people back to the cross. We always believe in the Holy Spirit. And we always bring people back to the Word of God. We always point the Word of God. You know, and everybody on the team has different gifts. You know, Kieran, a friend, has helped quite a few poor people. Mike's helped people who were homeless. And so everybody's got different gifts. And we all believe the importance of practical love, practical care. But we're not anti-intellectual. We don't have our head in the sand. We actually think about questions, and we talk to people in a reasoned way, and we're able to have a reasoned discussion with them if they want it. But we love them, and we depend on the Word, and we preach the cross, we preach the Holy Spirit, and we do practical things. I took a bag of clothes in a bin bag last week. Mike's given money. Mike's bought people dinner. Kieran's bought people. People who have been in the team have helped other people on the streets. So we don't just preach at people. When we can, we do try to help them if we can. Mike, tonight when I was preaching, there wasn't much happening, but then a lady came up who was drunk. She started to engage with me a little bit, but then she went to Mike, and then Mike was able to counsel her. And so we're a team where we have different gifts, and it's all about, at the end of the day, lifting the Lord. So the reason why I'm saying this is, you know, don't shy away from studying the Bible and answering people's questions, because, you know, that can be a part of your ministry as well, you know. And also don't shy away from preaching, because we preach tonight. Every time, if you notice, every time we preach, there's always somebody or some people end up either talking to you or Kieran, or we always get some conversation out of it. You know, sometimes it might seem a slog, And in summer, there are crowds, we do get big crowds that come and I'm able to debate and we can talk to people. But then there's the one-to-one. Mike's really good at it, Kieran's good at it, Nigel's good at it, I'm good at it. There's a lot of people on the team that are good at one-to-one. There's a couple of team on the team that are good at preaching. And other people have different gifts as well. Some people are strong. We've got somebody who knows Greek really well. You know, and people have different gifts and we complement each other. So when you say, you know, you shouldn't be preaching or you shouldn't be doing debates or whatever, you should just remember that there's a whole raft of things that we do and that we're about, and it's just part of what we do as a team. All right. Have you got any scripture that you want to share? Have you got one verse to share? Or and then do you want to close in prayer or do you want a final say?
I'm just trying to think of a scripture I could use.
I've got a really good one.
Go on then, I can't think of one.
Excuse me. It says this in, I think this is a really good verse for you to take for your ministry and to inspire you to reach out to people. And it's Matthew 23, verse 37, and it says this, O Jerusalem, Jerusalem, thou that killest the prophets and stonest them which are sent unto thee, how often would I have gathered thy children together, even as a hen gathereth her chicks under her wings, and you would not. And here we see the love of the Lord for the Jewish people there in Jerusalem. But that love that he had for Jerusalem and the people of Jerusalem, he has for the whole world. And, you know, we're motivated by love to reach the people who are lost. Because if they don't hear Jesus, when they die, they're going to go to hell. And we're to be motivated by love. And I hope that passage inspires you to have love in your heart for people. O Jerusalem, Jerusalem, thou that killest the prophets and stonest them which are sent unto thee, how often would I have gathered thy children together, even as a hen gathered their chicks under her wings, and you would not. So may that be a motto for you in your ministry and evangelism in the coming weeks ahead.
And also, when you evangelize, you might feel discouraged at times. But just remember, the Bible says that we are surrounded by a great cloud of witnesses. So every time that you go out and do the work and preach the gospel or talk to people, your work's not in vain. Heaven, the whole host of heaven is cheering you on to do this. So whatever you do, you're doing it for the Lord, and you're building up the kingdom and you're telling people of the kingdom of God. So the work that you do is recorded in heaven. God knows what you're doing. Jesus sees it and he's happy with it. So just do it and know that you've got authority, you've got kingdom authority to do this. And I would urge you to pray as well before you go out and do this. Pray, study, and just be strong in the Lord and trust in him.
And try and, like Mike said, work as a team. Try and get other people to join you. When I go out, I text about 30 people to pray. So try and build a group of people who pray for you. We also have a team. We have a really good team, don't we? Where we're united and we really work together, and then we also have people who associates who we meet up either in Liverpool or other places that we work together with, and we have some good relationships with people in Liverpool and other places, and so try and build a network of people who can support you and who you can work with, because it's not wise to be on your own. I'm not saying not to do that, but if you can, get people to come out with you. And also, it's biblical if you can work in conjunction with a local church or local leadership in some way, either a pastor or a church that can support you in some way in your local church. There's a lot of street preachers and evangelists that just do it off their own bat. I'm not saying that they're not used of God, but it's wise to be in a local fellowship and work with a church and liaise with your local church as well. That's biblical. Try and do multimedia, set up a website, set up a Twitter, set up Facebook, and mix it in with your open air work as well. You can use a table, put a table out, take a cross. We put a table out sometimes, we take a cross. We've got other ideas to do other stuff in the future, try do new ways as well. So just do what God's given you to do, the gifts that your team have. You know, someone might be able to sing. You don't know what gifts your group might have, but use the gifts that people have to reach out. But I would just encourage you to do it and just get on with it, get on with the task. It's not hard to just make a cross or and walk with a cross in your town centre, or stand on some step ladders, preach, or get a table and put a table out. I'm thinking about Mike, I've had an idea, I don't know what the guys will think, but to do some soup or something, bring some flasks and have a bit of soup so that the homeless can come in the cold weather and get some soup and stuff like that. So I'm thinking about that, and I'm going to mention it to the guys about that. Just take some big flasks and have a bit of soup for people who are homeless, and maybe take some bags of clothes if people need them. So those are things that you could do. I hope that's inspired you and encouraged you about Islam. If you're a Muslim, I hope that you've not been offended. We don't mean to offend you. We're just passionate about what we believe, and we want you to have a relationship with the Lord. So please don't be offended by anything that we've said. It comes from a sincere, genuine heart. But if you're a Christian, we hope that this video at least inspires you to do some evangelism yourself amongst Muslims, Mormons, Jews, Buddhists, Hindus, atheists, gay, lesbian activists, whatever. Just get out amongst them, and we hope that this video inspires you, and in particular concerning Islam. So thank you for listening. Don't forget website, jasonburnspreacher.com. Don't forget Jeremiah Ministries is a good ministry. And Answering Islam is an excellent website. And have you got a website that you want to recommend, Mike? Something that's been helped to you?
The one that we was watching before.
Sermon Audio is a really good resource for Bible teaching. So go down to Sermon Audio, and there's thousands of pastors down there that have got Bible teaching from good, solid churches that you can listen to. Sermon Audio.
Yeah.
All right, I'm going to ask Mike if you would have the last word and close in prayer. Yeah.
Okay, so thank you so much for listening to us. I hope what we said, I hope you've taken on board what we said. Like Jason said, we're not here to offend anyone, but we just want to build people up, and we want to bring the truth to all people. And the only way we're going to do it is by doing what we're doing, and to continue doing it. So we're just going to pray now for more of God, more of His Spirit, more of His way, more of